Korea is a small country, thousands of miles away. But what is happening there is important to every American. On Sunday, June 25th, communist forces attacked the Republic of Korea. Free nations must be on their guard, more than ever before, against this kind of sneak attack. We are united in detesting communist slavery. We know that the cost of freedom is high, but we are determined to preserve our freedom no matter what the cost.
Swarmed across the 38th parallel to attack unprepared South Korean defenders. Caught off guard, they were all but overwhelmed. Then the United Nations took its historic vote to intervene. While the Korean Republicans fought a desperate delaying action, a United Nations police force, General Douglas MacArthur, as commander-in-chief, was formed. During the early days of UN action, General MacArthur fought a grim defensive battle. His troops outnumbered 3-4-1. Stubbornly, forces under his command clung to the shrinking beachhead in Southeast Korea, and for months the Allies fought to keep from being driven into the sea. This, a savage war of attrition, in which no quarter was given by a foe equipped with the latest Russian armament, as they in fought time on the rapidly narrowing perimeter of their defense. In the first months of conflict, casualties mounted to terminate.
MacArthur never accepted that premise. In fact, he rejected, in my hearing on countless occasions, any talk of a need to withdraw. He knew that we could hold.
General Walker had told us, no further withdrawal. This is it.
And 40,000 men were landed behind the enemy's lines in an operation executed without luggage. Seemingly, the war had reached a turning point as the fresh troops started an encircling move of the North Koreans. Well-armed and equipped, they moved steadily forward to the Manchurian border. The war seemed in sight as the Allies pushed north toward the North Korean capital of Pyongyang and further northward to the Manchurian and Siberian border. Then it happened.
Then the weather turned bad. Dropped to 10 to 20 degrees below zero.
It was cold. You sleep in it, you eat in it, you live in it, you fight in it.
Flares went up. Mortars guys sent up flares, and we could see them. I mean, there were just a horde of them coming at us.
And I looked up, and I seen green tracers going one way, which are Chinese tracers, are green. Red ones the other way, and I thought, holy.
There was hundreds of them down in this ravine, about 50 yards away, and we were machine gunning the hell out of them. You knew every time you fired your rifle, you're killing somebody, but it certainly wasn't stopping anybody.
There were so many people. They were moving and weaving. It looked like them. Wind blowing across a wheat field.
There they were, without weapons. Some of them barefooted, some of them in shorts, and they were damn near frozen stiff.
We use frozen Chinese bodies as sandbags.
I shoved my K-bar straight through and it came out the back of his neck. That just squirted blood all over me.
We turned around and they were right behind us. My sleeping bag was there, and we killed eight of them right on top of my sleeping bag.
So he calls up and says, what's the situation down there, old man? said, well, the enemy's got me cut off in the rear now, and of course they're between me and you, and they're on the right and on the left. And there was this moment of silence. So what are you going to do? And here's the difference between surviving on a floor and not surviving. I said, attack! Good boy. Well, look.
It wasn't a retreat. It was an attack from another direction. Turned around and pointed my guns the other way. Went my way to the sea.
Coming out of the reservoir were the truckloads of dead Marines. We had loaded up like so much firewood, logs in these trucks, the bodies frozen, rigid. We were going to take out every body, and we did.